van a ver el seminario de Guadalupe en vivo a través de esta plataforma. Y a los que no, bueno, ya les mandé un correo diciéndoles que la doctora Sabio aceptó grabar su charla, por lo tanto, le solicitan a Omar acceso y él les dará acceso para que puedan ver la plática cuando mejor les convenga. Es un gusto para mí presentarles a la doctora Sabio. Ella es veterinaria de la Universidad de Extremadura, donde también realizó su tesis de maestría y después para el doctorado lo hizo en una colaboración conjunta entre la Universidad de Dundee en el British Medical Research Council y con la misma Universidad de Extremadura, donde inició a trabajar con las kinases que son, creo, el amor de su vida, las MAP kinases, en particular P38. Allá trabajó también con el doctor Philip Cohen, que fue uno de los pioneros en clonar las primeras fosfatasas de tirosina. Después, para su postdoctorado, se movió a la Universidad de Massachusetts en Worcester con el papá de las MAP kinases, el doctor Roger Davis, donde Guadalupe hizo contribuciones muy importantes al entendimiento del papel de estas kinases en el control del metabolismo. Y bueno, Guadalupe ha publicado muchos artículos en las mejores revistas, por ejemplo, Cell Metabolism, Molecular Cell Biology, Journal of Immunology, Genes and Development, etcétera, etcétera. Esta productividad de Guadalupe le valió después obtener una posición como investigador independiente en el Centro Nacional de Investigaciones Cardiovasculares Carlos III en España, donde labora actualmente. Y bueno, su grupo continúa siendo muy productivo en esta área. Y Guadalupe también ha sido reconocida con diferentes premios, por ejemplo, el L'Oréal UNESCO en España, el Príncipe Girón en el 2012, uno de los más recientes, el Envoy Young Investigator en el 2017, entre otros reconocimientos. Entonces, le agradezco mucho a Guadalupe una vez más haber aceptado la invitación. La idea era que estuviera presente aquí en México, bueno, ya será en otra ocasión que pueda visitarnos en Cuernavaca. En Guadalupe, adelante. Solo les comento que para las preguntas, por favor, levante la manita y les estaremos dando la palabra. Adelante, Guadalupe.
Muchas gracias por la invitación, Gustavo. Voy a intentar poner la diapositiva. A ver si... No soy capaz.
Ahí va.
¿Ahí?
Sí.
Ahí está, listo.
Vamos a apagar nuestras cámaras para que haya mejor conectividad, pero aquí estamos todos presentes.
Thank you very much for the introduction. It's for me a pleasure to be here. It's a pity that I will not be there, but I hope that in the future, when this pandemic will finish, I will be there and visit Cuernavaca. Thank you, Gustavo, for inviting me. I'm going to talk today about what we know about the role of the stress kinases in metabolic diseases.
Guadalupe, ¿me escuchas?
Sí.
Estamos viendo tu presentación, pero no en el formato de full screen.
Ah, creo, vale.
El otro.
Entonces, voy a salir de aquí. A ver.
Ahora.
Uh-huh. ¿Ahora?
Ya, perfecto, gracias.
Obesity has become a growing epidemic, and we know that the number of people obese is increasing all over the world. And with this increase in obesity, we have also an increase in the related obesity disease. No me quiere pasar. Sorry, doesn't want to pass. Okay. With obesity, When we are obese, the excess of lipid that cannot be stored in the adipose tissue is going to be stored in other tissues that are not used to this increase of lipids. For example, the liver, the pancreas, the muscle, and the heart, inducing secondary diseases like steatosis, diabetes, or cardiovascular diseases. Is something wrong with okay? In during the in this process, the role of the stress kinases have been very important, especially the role of the GNK1 that we demonstrated that mice that are doesn't have GNK1 are protected against obesity, and moreover that depletion of GNK1 in adipose tissue protect animal against diabetes, but the animal still are obese. When I come back to Spain, I decided to study the other stress kinases, the P38 kinases, and we found that these kinases were important in the inflammation. And this inflammation is a very important step during the development of steatosis in the liver. We found, for example, that P38 gamma and delta control TNF-alpha translation, a very important cytokine that is going to control a liver steatosis. For that reason, we decided to check what was the role of these kinases in this disease. We generate mice that doesn't have P38 gamma and delta in myeloid compartment, only in macrophage and neutrophils. And we found that when we deplete P38 gamma and delta from this cell, we protect the animal against steatosis after a MCD diet, that is a diet that doesn't have or choline, and this diet induces a severe NAS in the liver. When we don't have P38 gamma and delta in this myeloid compartment, we found a complete protection of this animal, and when we stain this liver with red oil, that is this dot that stain lipids in the liver, we found that the accumulation of this lipid in the conditional animal was reduced, suggesting that only the depletion of P38 gamma and delta in myeloid compartment was enough to protect the animals against this disease. We quantified the triglyceride in this liver, and we found that this animal depot less triglyceride, and we also measure liver damage measuring ALT in the blood, and we found that the mice were also protected against this liver damage. This data indicate that inhibiting P38 gamma and delta in this myeloid compartment could be a very important treatment for the development of steatosis. During this time, we were checking whether these kinases could be important also in the development of steatosis in humans. And for that, we checked the expression of this P38 gamma in obese patients in the liver, and we found that there are increased of P38 gamma expression in obese livers. Moreover, there are an increase of P38 gamma expression in liver that of lean individuals, but they have NALF or NASH, suggesting that P38 gamma increase when we have a damaged liver. Then, because we know that steatosis and obesity is a predisposing factor for hepatocellular carcinoma, and that P38 gamma increased during this process, because we found an increase of P38 gamma in NALF and NAS, we ask ourselves whether in this progression of the disease until the hepatocellular carcinoma, we have a different expression of P38 gamma. That was the project of Antonia Tomás Loba in the lab, that was a postdoctoral research, and he asked what was the function of P38 gamma in this hepatocyte that progressed in the disease to the liver cancer. And the first question was, Is P38 gamma affected during this progression? Is P38 gamma affected by the increase of fibrosis in this liver? And the answer was yes. When we check the level of P38 gamma in biopsies, and we correlate with two markers of fibrosis, called 1A or actin, we found that P38 gamma directly correlates with the level of collagen or actin, indicating that P38 gamma increase in the human liver when the human liver is exposed to fibrosis, and suggesting that this protein could have a role in this in the progression of the disease. Because as I mentioned, fibrosis is a step to develop hepatocellular carcinoma, and to be able to transition from a NASH to hepatocellular carcinoma, we need a chronic hepatocyte proliferation. We decided to check what was the role of this kinase in cell cycle progression and hepatocyte proliferation. For that, we decided to use a very nice model, that is the partial hepatectomy. In the partial hepatectomy, we take out a piece of liver, and because the liver have this huge capacity of regeneration, when we take out a piece of liver, the liver is going to, the hepatocytes are going to initiate the proliferation of the cell, and to increase this proliferation in order to achieve the same mass of liver. And we ask in this initiation of proliferation, gamma was active, and the answer was yes. When we check for the phosphorylation of P38 gamma in this liver after the 48 hour after the hepatectomy, we see a nice phosphorylation of P38 gamma, indicating that P38 gamma is active in this step. Then we decided to check what was the function or what was the necessity of P38 gamma in this initiation of proliferation. And we used mice that doesn't have P38 gamma now, only in hepatocytes, and we wild type animals that are the alkyl mice, and we do partial hepatectomy in both animals. And we found that when we stain with BRDU, that stain the nucleus that are starting to be initiation, the proliferation, we found that after 48 hours, as expected, after the hepatectomy, wild-type animal initiate this proliferation, and we found a lot of hepatocytes that are proliferating. When we don't have P38 gamma in hepatocyte, we don't see this increased proliferation after the partial hepatectomy, and we can quantify the number of hepatocytes that are in S phase, in the proliferation state, and there are very few hepatocytes that initiate proliferation when we don't have P38 gamma. Moreover, if we wait until 15 days after the surgery, the liver are going to recover the initial site, and we can see that in the wild-type animal, but not in the knockout animal, that doesn't recover this increase of site in the liver, suggesting that P38 gamma in hepatocyte is necessary for the initiation of the proliferation and for the regeneration of the liver after partial hepatectomy. It has been described the signaling pathway that control this initiation of proliferation, and this initiation of proliferation is regulated by the CDKs, that there are cyclin-dependent kinases that are activated when they bind to a cyclin, and when they are in this complex, the CDK with the cyclin, they are going to phosphorylate RB. RB, phosphorylated RB, are going to be released from the E2F, and E2F is going to bind to the promoter and initiate the transcription of important gene in the cell cycle progression. Because we were wondering that this this control of proliferation normally is regulated by mitogen kinases, because cycling are quite regulated by mitogen kinase. By what happens if the cell need to initiate the proliferation not as a mitogen stimuli but as a stress stimuli? And we know that both families, the CDKs and the P38, belong to the big family of the CMGCs. And also both families, the CDKs and the P38 gamma, are very similar if we check for the kinase assay, suggesting that perhaps they can share some of the substrate. Moreover, we knew that historical reason, P38 gamma and P38 delta are in the P38 family, but they don't have all the feature that the P38 family have. For example, they don't have the homology with the P38 alpha and beta. They only share 60% of homology. They don't have the same sensitivity to chemical inhibitor. Inhibitor for P38 gamma and delta cannot inhibit P38 alpha and beta. They also doesn't share substrate specificity, and we have a substrate specific for P38 alpha and beta, and substrates that they are specific for gamma and delta. And why they are in the same family? The reason, the historical reason, is because they have the same upstream activator, NKK3 and NKK6. All these four kinases are activated by NKK3 and NKK6 after a stress stimuli. Then we decide, okay, if they are not so identical to P38, they are activated by stress, and they are very similar in the kinase assay, in the kinase domain in with CDK, perhaps they have feature of CDK protein. And the first thing that we ask is whether CDK1 and P38 gamma could have similar inhibitors. There will be sharing inhibitor, and we found that yes, this inhibitor, that is the RO3306, that is a CDK1 inhibitor, is able to bind to P38 gamma, and not only that, it's bind completely perfect in the docking site and also inhibit the activity of the enzyme, suggesting that both families can share inhibitor. The second feature for belonging to the same family is to share a substrate. And we decide, okay, if we see that we found a difference in the proliferation, and RB is an important substrate for initiate this proliferation, could be possible that P38 gamma will phosphorylate RB under stress stimuli, where CDKs cannot be activated because the level of cycling are very low. And we check that in vitro, we phosphorylate RB with CDKs and also with P38 gamma. And we found that P38 gamma was able to phosphorylate RB in the same residues and almost with the same intensity that the CDKs, suggesting that both kinases share this substrate. To further investigate whether P38 gamma could phosphorylate RB in the liver, we decided to check whether P38 gamma bind to RB in our liver. And for that, we immunoprecipitate P38 gamma from livers of wild type and cow mice. And only in the mice that have P38 gamma in the wild type, we see that RB is able to bind to P38 gamma and appear in the immunoprecipitated, suggesting that these two proteins are bind in the hepatocyte and that P38 gamma is able to phosphorylate RB in vivo. To further demonstrate that P38 gamma is able to phosphorylate RB in vivo, we decide to infect animal with adeno-associated virus that express P38 gamma active only in hepatocytes. And we found that when we do that, we have here the wild type. When we do the partial hepatectomy, we see a nice phosphorylation of RB in wild type mice that disappear in the knockout animals, suggesting that P30 gamma is an important regulator of this phosphorylation. And the final demonstration that P30 gamma is important in this phosphorylation is when we acutely put back P30 gamma in the hepatocyte, we are able to restore the phosphorylation of RV in vivo in the liver, indicating that P30 gamma is able to phosphorylate RV. To further check what is the significance of this phosphorylation, we check whether this recovery of the RB phosphorylation was important in the proliferation. And we found that yes, when we stain the liver with Ki-67, that is a marker of proliferation, again, we see that in wild-type mice, we have a nice proliferation after 48 hours that is a lack in the mice that doesn't have P30 gamma in hepatocyte, but that is completely recovered when we put back P30 gamma active. And we can see here the quantification and here the recovery in the liver weight, suggesting that when we put back P30 gamma, we are able to recover completely the phosphorylation of RB and, in consequent, the proliferation of the cells. And this is our hypothesis. Our hypothesis is that we need two different family or two different signaling pathways to control proliferation. We have the canonical pathway of proliferation, that is the one that every single cell has, that is initiated by mitogen, when cell have really physiologically to need to divide. The mitogen are going to induce the expression of cyclin, that they are going to bind to CDKs, and they are going to initiate the phosphorylation of RB, and with that, the proliferation. But when we have a stress stimuli that also need the cell to respond with a proliferation, we don't have cyclin in the cells. We need another signaling pathway that in this case is going to initiate the proliferation in a cyclin independent manner. And we found that P30 gamma, at least in hepatocyte, is a very important regulator of this stress-induced proliferation. And what is the meaning of this proliferation for human disease? We decide to check what happened in human during the development of liver cancer, and we found that in human of in biopsies from humans of ACC, we found an increase of the P30 gamma expression in the tumor, suggesting that this protein is important in the tumor progression. Not only that, when we check the level of P30 gamma in the cord, we differentiate between low expression of P30 gamma and high expression of P30 gamma, we found that the lower expression of P30 gamma correlating with a higher lifespan, suggesting that high expression of P30 gamma was deleterious and was increasing the mortality of the patient. Moreover, when we check in mice, what happened in mice when we induced ACC, we found that not only in a chemical induced ACC, in a DNA, DIN model in which we induce ACC with a tumorigenic, we found P30 gamma activation. But not only then, when we induce the liver cancer with two other models, one that is a model and one that is a proliferating model, in both cases, we found that P30 gamma is active, suggesting that is necessary this activation of P38 gamma for the progression of the liver cancer. To demonstrate that, what we did is to check what happened when we induced liver cancer in our mice model, in the wild type mice, and in the mice that doesn't have P38 gamma in hepatocyte. And we found that when we induced the tumor in the wild type mice, we found an increase of tumor after 8 months that doesn't appear or was quite reduced when we don't have P38 gamma. Here is the quantification. We have lower number of tumor, lower tumor size, and also the survival of the animal was increased, suggesting that P38 gamma is important for the progression of this liver cancer. To demonstrate that P38 gamma inhibition could be used as a possible treatment for the disease, we decide to deplete P38 gamma later in the time. What we did is we induced the tumor at 15 days. We wait until 6 months, where the five months, where the tumor are already there, and we can check with MRI. And here, when we found that we can see the tumor, then we deplete P38 gamma using adeno-associated virus that express the kinase that are going to deplete the P38 gamma gene from the genome of the cells. And when we do that, we found that even later in the progression of the tumor, depletion of P38 gamma was protecting the mice. We have a reduced tumor size and reduced number of tumors. In summary, what we found is that P38 gamma is going to phosphorylate RB, and this phosphorylation of RB that is induced by stress is going to be also held by CDKs and cycling, and is going to be quite important in the development of liver cancer. This open a new window to be able to treat this tumor, because the difference between P38 gamma and CDKs is that P38 gamma is activated, control proliferation only under stress stimuli, while CDKs is necessary for the proliferation of every single cell in the body. That means inhibiting P38 gamma will have the good thing that we are not going to inhibit the proliferation of other cells like our gut cell or other cells in our body that need to proliferate constantly. We wanted to also to understand what was the function of P38 gamma and delta in the myelin compartment that we described that doesn't have P38 gamma and delta was important in the myelin compartment to protect against liver and to steatosis. And demonstrate that P38 gamma and delta in neutrophil control the neutrophil migration to the liver. And this neutrophil migration in the liver was important controlling liver metabolism. Then we decided to check what was so important in neutrophil to be able to control hepatocyte metabolism, and whether changes in neutrophil infiltration during the day and the night could be important in the regulation of the circadian metabolism in the liver. This project was initiated by Nuria and Barbara long time back, and ended by Maria and Magda recently, in which they tried to understand what was the role of P38 gamma and delta in neutrophil. But later on, what we were trying to understand was what was the role of neutrophil in the circadian control of the liver metabolism. And we know that circadian rhythmicity is controlled by different nuclear receptors, that they are expressed in the nucleus, like CLOCK and BMAL are going to control other nuclear receptors that are going to be expressed, and they are going to repress the expression of CLOCK and BMAL, and this cycle is around 24 hours. Every single cell have a circadian clock, and also every single cell is controlled also for the supracrestmac circadian clock. And among this cell, neutrophil also have a circadian clock, and it has been demonstrated that the level of neutrophil in the blood is different during the night and the day. And this different amount of neutrophil and macrophage in the blood could be important, for example, for the answer to infection that is not the same in night and day. Our question was whether this infiltration in the neutrophil, this amount of neutrophil not only in blood but also in the tissue, could be also important in the regulation of the tissue metabolism. For that, the first question was, is the infiltration of neutrophil different during the day and the night? And the answer was yes. We checked for that is this marker infiltrated in the liver during the day and the night. And we see that during the day, we have a peak of neutrophil infiltrated in the liver, and there are here in the night neutrophil infiltrated in. And then we ask whether this higher level of neutrophil infiltration in the liver correlate with any of the nuclear receptors that we said that they are important in the regulation of the circadian rhythmicity. And we found that yes, when we have a peak in the neutrophil infiltration, we have a peak in the level of BMAL, and when we have an nadir in the neutrophil infiltration, we have an nadir in the level of and also in the level of CLOCK. And of course, that is going in the other way, is the opposite, have the opposite curve. Then we have a correlation between neutrophil infiltration at the level of the CLOCK genes, and we decide to also check whether this also correlates with changes in the metabolism, and we found that yes, higher neutrophil infiltration during the day of C32 in air is correlating with higher level of triglyceride contained in this liver, and lower level of triglyceride acetyl-14 is correlated with lower level of triglyceride in the liver. Suggesting that all these three steps happen in the same time, but we don't know whether the neutrophil are controlling the CLOCK genes still. As I mentioned, to further investigate that, we decide to use this neutrophil that doesn't have P38 gamma and delta, and these mice, the neutrophil are not going to arrive to the liver. What we see is correlating with high level of neutrophil in the liver, in the wild type, we have a high level of BMAL in the wild type, and correlating with low level of neutrophil in this liver, because the knockout cannot infiltrate in the liver, the neutrophil, we have a low level of BMAL. And the opposite happened with PER and GRI that are negatively regulated by BMAL, suggesting that at least in this model, neutrophil infiltration correlates with high level of BMAL. Then we decide to modulate this neutrophil infiltration with different diet, and we check for high-fat diet and methionine-choline deficient diet, that are two diets that are going to increase the neutrophil infiltration and also are going to induce steatosis. And what we found is that in normal mice, in control mice, we see an increase of BMAL when we put the mice in MCD diet. However, in neutropenic mice, mice that doesn't have neutrophils, we don't see this increase in BMAL in the liver, suggesting that this increase of BMAL in the liver after the MCD diet is regulated by this increase in neutrophil infiltration. Moreover, we checked how was this correlating with the liver steatosis, and we found that while control mice after MCD diet induced the accumulation of lipids in the liver, when we don't have neutrophils in this liver, we are protected against this steatosis, suggesting again that the three steps are correlated. To really demonstrate that neutrophil control clock gene in hepatocyte, we decide to check in vitro whether if we stimulate hepatocyte in vitro with neutrophil, we change the expression of the clock gene, and the answer was yes. We have an increase of BMAL and increase of clock when we stimulate the hepatocyte with neutrophil. Increase of BMAL and clock was correlated with increase of GNK activity. Two. Then we decided to what was a signal that neutrophil secreting to induce these changes in the hepatocyte. And we know that neutrophil expressed elastase. There was some manuscript that indicate there would be a nice activity of GNK. Then we decide, okay, we are going to check whether elastase have the same effect. And the answer was yes. When we put elastase instead of neutrophil, we found that elastase alone was able to increase BMAL expression and clock expression in hepatocyte and also induce GNK activation. To really demonstrate that elastase is an important regulator of clock gene, we decide to use these mice that doesn't have elastase in the neutrophils. And we found that when these mice doesn't have elastase in the neutrophils, we don't have young activation in the hepatocyte of the liver of these mice. This is the wild type. After the MCD diet, GNK is activated in partially in, and this is the GNK in the knockout of elastase that is the reduced activation. And this activation, reduced activation of GNK also correlates with a reduced BMAL expression, suggesting again that elastase activates GNK and GNK control BMAL expression. Moreover, when we check whether this difference in the expression of BMAL was correlating with changes in the lipid deposition in this liver, we found that yes, wild-type mice have increased lipid deposition, while the mice that doesn't have elastase in the neutrophil are protected against this steatosis. Then, to really demonstrate that GNK was very important in the control of this clock gene, we decided to to use the inhibitor of GNK in wild-type and in neutropenic mice. Because in wild-type mice, we have the induction of elastase by the neutrophil, we will expect that GNK inhibition will have an effect. However, in neutropenic mice that we don't have the stimuli that activate GNK, we will expect that the GNK inhibition doesn't have any long further effect. And first of all, we check that the inhibitor was working in the liver. When we treat the mice with the inhibitor, we see a reduction of substrate, C-Jun phosphorylation. When we also, because in the neutropenic mice, we don't have neutrophils, we have from the beginning lower activation of C-Jun that is not further inhibited by the inhibitor. And that correlates when we have an inhibition in wild-type mice, we have a reduction of the expression of BMAL because we don't have here any longer young activation. However, here we already have very low level of BMAL because we don't have from the beginning young activity. And the same happened with clock, and this data suggests that GNK regulate these clock genes. finally, to demonstrate that the light is controlling this effect, we decide to stimulate with beta-3 adrenergic, and we have that after beta-3 adrenergic stimulation, neutrophils are going to infiltrate in the liver. This is the neutrophil from wild-type mice, and this is neutrophil from elastase cow mice, but they don't have elastase, but they infiltrate in the liver in the same way. And when we check what happened in these animals, when we stimulate them with beta-3 adrenergic stimuli, we found that beta-3 induced the expression of CLOC and BMAL in this liver. However, this expression was no longer there in the elastase cow mice, because this mice doesn't produce elastase, suggesting that the control of this circadian rhythmicity is initiated by the stimulation of beta-3 adrenergic from the central nervous system. As a summary, what we think is happening is that neutrophils are going to be infiltrated in the liver in a circadian way. They are going to be a high infiltration of neutrophil during the day, that this infiltration of neutrophil in the day are going to release elastase, that they are going to activate GNK, and GNK is going to control the expression of BMAL and CLOC, and is going to the lipogenesis in this liver. However, during the night, there are a reduction of neutrophil infiltration. This reduction of neutrophil infiltration is going to result in reduction of channel activation that is going to reduce the expression of BMAL and CLOC, and is going to increase lipolysis and reduce the level of lipid in these livers. This control of clotting in the liver have been quite important in the regulation of the liver cancer, because deregulation of the liver clotting and jet lag of the mice is going to induce cholestasis, and that is going to induce liver cancer. And then we ask ourselves, if JAN is so important in the liver clotting regulation, what happens if we don't have JAN in the liver? And we found that the mice that doesn't have JAN in the liver have a deregulation of all the CLOC genes, not only BMAL, but also CLOC, PER, and CRY. And then we decide, okay, if the deregulation of the CLOC gene could be an important trigger for ACC development, what happens if we left these mice to get older and see what if they die more? And what we found is that when we these mice that doesn't have JAN1 and JAN2 in the liver, they have deregulation of the bilic acid production, that is an important process that needs a circadian rhythmicity, and they develop liver tumor. In this case, they develop cholangiosarcoma, and this cholangiosarcoma is controlled by the hyperactivation of ERK in the cholangiocyte, because this deregulation in the bilic acid production. And as a summary, what we found is that when we don't have GNK in hepatocyte, we have an hyperactivation of PPR and FGF25, F15, that are going to induce the signaling of ERK activation in the cholangiocyte, that are going to proliferate and induce cholangiosarcoma. And with that, I will finish. Thank you, the people of my lab. I think the only person that I didn't mention during the talk was Elisa Manieri. That was the person that was performing the last experiment in the JAN double knockout with Alfonso Mora, that they were the two leading person in that project. I want to thank the rest of the people of my lab, because we all work together, the people in the hospital of Salamanca that give us sample from human to be able to translate our research into human, and all the people in CENIC and outside that have helped us to do this work in now and in the past. Thank you very much. I will be happy to answer any question.
Gracias, Guadalupe, por esta muy interesante plática. Por favor, los que tengan preguntas, levanten la manita y los voy dando la palabra de acuerdo al orden en que aparezcan las manitas levantadas. Mario Zurita, por favor.
Hola. ¿En inglés o en español? La cuestión.
Como quieras.
Bueno, mejor en español, porque no soy experto en el tema. Pero yo, en una situación de estrés, la misma vía, las mismas vías que mostraste de la young kinase y de la P38 gamma, también, no sé la P38 gamma, pero también la misma vía bajo estrés induce apoptosis. Uh-huh. Entonces, ¿cómo se regula la decisión, si es que se sabe, entre apoptosis y proliferación en estas condiciones?
Bueno, realmente las estrés kinasas, por ejemplo, la P38 alfa, tiene más esa función de apoptosis que la P38 gamma. Y no se sabe específicamente cómo, porque ambas pueden, se activan como con los mismos estímulos, pero van a tener diferentes sustratos. Y además de tener diferentes sustratos, se piensa que tienen diferentes proteínas scaffold que las van a colocar con esos sustratos y van a hacer que se coloquen seguramente en diferentes zonas de la célula. Sin embargo, en profundidad, cómo se hace y cómo es la mecanística, todavía estamos muy lejos de saberlo, porque realmente mientras que se han conocido más proteínas scaffold para la vía de la JNK, para la vía de la P38 se conocen pocas y se conocen muy poquitos sustratos de P38 gamma y delta, porque casi toda la información que tenemos es de P38 alfa.
Gracias.
Jean-Louis, por favor.
Sí, hola. Muy bonita plática. Yo también no soy nada experto en esto, pero me parece muy interesante todo lo que platicaste. Y una duda que tengo es en relación a la elastasa. O sea, ¿cómo es que activa la junk? ¿Me podrías explicar?
Los datos indican que la elastasa activa la junk a través de TLR4. Y que cuando inhibimos TLR4, se inhibe esa activación de la JNK.
Ajá. Y digamos, ¿esto es un evento específico de esta enzima? O sea, ¿sí? ¿Qué tantas otras opciones de activación hay de este camino?
Nosotros probamos otras como proteasas, como la elastasa, o sea, para ver si era específico de la elastasa o podría haber otras proteasas y no encontramos otras proteasas. Intentamos también otras células inmunes, por ejemplo, células T o macrófagos, y tampoco encontramos que otras células inmunes tuvieran este efecto. Parece un efecto bastante específico de los neutros y en específico de la elastasa.
Okay, muchas gracias.
Adelante, Patricia. No te escuchamos. Sí, Bueno, no sé si Patricia tenga problemas con su micrófono, si alguien quiere preguntar en lo que Patricia resuelve el problema.
A ver, ¿ya?
Ya, ahora sí.
Adelante. Perdón, yo lo quité de un lado, pero no del otro. Bueno, perdón. La pregunta era ligada hacia el efecto de glucocorticoides. Porque, por ejemplo, un kinasa te saca el GR, el receptor de glucocorticoides del núcleo, y pueden intervenir en muchas de las vías que mencionaste. No sé si haya datos clínicos o que tú hayas contemplado cuál sería la interacción con glucocorticoides en el sistema.
No hemos contemplado la interacción de glucocorticoides en el sistema. Hemos visto que esta vía puede controlar, más que Yang, hemos visto que las P38 pueden controlar los glucocorticoides, pero no hemos llegado a determinar qué papel tienen los glucocorticoides en ninguno de estos efectos.
Ok.
¿Alguna otra pregunta? Bueno, en lo que se animan, a mí me gustaría hacer una... o sea, la parte de esta regulación de la proliferación por la P38 respuesta a estrés, evidentemente lo demostraron claramente muy bien en el hígado, que es un órgano que regenera bastante fácil. O sea, ¿tú crees que esta misma vía estaría en otros órganos, aunque no tengan la misma capacidad de regeneración que el hígado?
Hemos visto que, por ejemplo, o sea, que no, esta vía no tiene efectos en la regeneración fisiológica, por ejemplo, de nuestro intestino cuando está en estado normal, pero sí cuando provocamos un daño. Por ejemplo, si le damos a los animales de beber DSS e inducimos tumores en el intestino, entonces sí, P38 gamma se activa. Y entonces sí, los ratones que no tienen P38 gamma, esto no lo hemos hecho en específico, solo lo hicimos en el ratón total, si no tienen P38 gamma el ratón, esta proliferación está disminuida.
Bueno, tengo otra pregunta, pero no la quiero hacer. Quiero ver que alguien más del público si tiene preguntas. No veo manitas arriba. Bueno, entonces hago mi pregunta, mi segunda pregunta. Entonces, digamos que esta desregulación del ciclo circadiano cuando los animales están sometidos a un exceso de energía, ya sea por la dieta hipercalórica, se da precisamente porque se desregula la salida de los neutrófilos del tejido hepático.
Lo que nosotros hemos visto es que cuando, o sea, por ejemplo, cuando le damos dietas hipercalóricas, hay una mayor infiltración de neutrófilos en el tejido hepático y eso hace que se desregule el ciclo circadiano del hígado. Si, por ejemplo, somete a los ratones a ciclos de jet lag y cambia los ciclos de día y noche, también tiene el mismo efecto. Aumenta la infiltración de neutrófilos y se produce esteatosis y te cambian los clotting y también es dependiente de esos neutrófilos. Lo que indicaría como que ambas vías están unidas y que tanto la dieta, la desregulación, la obesidad que desregula el ritmo circadiano del hígado como una desregulación central por cambios de noche y día, ambos se vehiculan por una mayor infiltración de neutrófilos y un cambio del ritmo circadiano del hígado. Sí.
Gracias, Guadalupe. Bueno, creo que no hay más preguntas. Pues no me queda más que agradecerte y felicitarte por los resultados muy bonitos que están generando en su laboratorio.